And a good evening, depending on what time it is, to another wild and crazy edition of What's Trending. I'm Rany Filiault. We've got Deb Hamel to the right of me, Jokers to the left. No, Terry Clark to the left. There's a song about that, you know. Jerry Sickels, here we are on show two. He's already called in sick. Yes. I think we intimidated the bejesus out of him a week ago, and, you know, we'll see.
I think he's on his way to the inauguration.
Yes. He actually's not going to go. No. Said he couldn't afford it.
I wouldn't go.
Oh, really?
Yeah. Oh, rooms are like $900 a night if you can get one. Oh, my. And of walking.
No. Ray Buckley just tweeted this morning that he never saw Washington, D.C. so boring. He was eating breakfast alone in a major motel. There was nobody there.
And Ray Buckley is a House member?
No. Ray Buckley is he's the chairman of the New Hampshire Democratic Party, and he's running to become head of the Democratic National Committee. I'm told he doesn't have much of a chance because there's some really heavy hitters.
Your name in, right?
No, some of the people who raise millions and millions of dollars. I guess that's more important these days.
But. Well, as we're taping the show, it's on a Wednesday, and by the time it airs for people watching, the inauguration will have already taken place, or otherwise known as our National Day of Mourning.
No.
I've heard actually, I've heard there are rooms available down there that I went down some years ago when Clinton got first elected. Mm-hmm. So if anybody ever gets a chance to go to an inauguration, definitely do it.
Do it.
I mean, it's once in a lifetime. You won't do it a second time because it's crazy.
Yeah.
Security, I mean, it's fun, but at the same time, it's very chaotic. But it's a once in a lifetime, and hopefully with Trump, this is definitely a once in a lifetime. We don't want to do this a second time.
No, there'll be a second time. Everything's going to be fine. It's going to be groovy. Fine.
Yeah, yeah. It's just going to be
trust
groovy.
Me.
Was that his campaign song?
No. Feeling slow down, groovy. Yeah.
It's going to be interesting.
It's going to be great, and I just think it's a shame that all those House members are not going, are sitting it out. That's kind of like they're angry, they're upset, so doesn't that seem me, how they feel? They're representing their state. I think they should go. And I still say Jean Shaheen is the greatest. I love her. She's going.
Mm-hmm.
And I've always thought very highly of Jean Shaheen, but I just don't get all of those House members not going.
Well, one of ours is going to church instead to pray for the nation. I thought that was different.
I read some of the comments on that. Some of them said, oh, you Democrats, you're all a bunch of whiners and you won't go. But as I was reading, looking back, when Obama got in, you might want to take a look at the amount of Republicans that didn't show up and didn't go. So,
well, actually, it's
a pendulum thing.
Actually, there are probably more Democratic congresspeople who aren't attending, but there are some Republicans as well. I heard one on NPR the other day talking about how disappointed he was, and he said that he could have supported any of the other Republican nominees. I guess he was originally Jeb's man, but I guess those people they got taken out pretty early, didn't they?
Yes.
Yeah. That was in the spring.
Yeah.
Well, basically, what I found, and you know, to show that Republicans and Democrats kind of get along. My wife Holly and I and Deb, we went together to visit to see a few of the candidates.
Yes, we did.
But one thing I did notice, Deb, was every time we went to see one with you, they dropped out like the next week. Deb was like, I'm with.
I know that feeling. Since 1990, I think the 1992 election. During the primaries, I would always back the loser. I'd always come around, for the eventual nominee. But my first choice was always someone who came in second or third.
Like Bernie.
Yeah. Bernie actually, yeah. Well, I don't like to talk about that.
A lot of people
come to my eyes.
I know.
Gosh, what a shame! What a shame! What an opportunity this country missed by not giving him the nomination. Actually, it was, God.
It would have been interesting. It would have been interesting.
Just imagine the things that could have been.
I still feel that Bernie would have won because when you look at how close some of those states were that put Trump over the top, right. you're talking, handful of voters. And one thing that they were showing, as we all know now, that is the amount of voters that didn't show up for the Democrats. The ones that actually voted for Obama, they didn't come out and vote. They stayed home. So, you know, if you stayed home, and that's one of the things that just fries me when you watch some of the protesters on TV being interviewed after the election, uh-huh. that they were out there rallying against Trump. He's not my president. It's like, did you vote? No.
No.
Then shut up.
That's,
you know,
I agree.
I mean, that's the very least you do is go in and just make a check mark. That's right. And if you can't do that, I mean, think about that. They couldn't take, you know, whatever it is, you know, in Keene, a half an hour, some cities a couple hours, but whatever. You didn't have the time to go make one check mark, but you have time to protest day after day, week after week.
Be a nuisance.
So just, you know, you don't vote, shut up.
Speaking of voting, Keene City Councilors will have an opportunity to vote on the replacement for Jay Kahn. The filing period starts Monday. Mm-hmm. It's going to be a week through the 31st. So any Keene resident who's of the age of majority can come and register. And I encourage anyone from any walk of life to think about being a member of the council, because it really is quite an experience. You know, you don't have to have any particular expertise other than being just a person with, you know, with a point of view, mm-hmm. and some love of the community helps.
I think you're absolutely right. It's not an expertise thing. It's actually love of the community. Mm-hmm. Now, we've seen in the past where somebody might come in just because they're angry about one thing. That's not the right reason to come
in. That never works.
And you're going to get buried.
That never works.
You know, you're not going to accomplish anything on council if you're just coming in with a negative attitude on a particular position.
Right, a one-position candidate.
Yep, and you've seen them.
Oh, yeah.
You've been there, too. And they just get buried, and they get frustrated, and they just go away.
Yes.
Right, because one thing that a lot of people don't really realize is there's 15 of us, and in order to get something done, you need 8 votes.
Exactly. You need a majority.
You need to get along with your other counselors.
Somewhat get along.
Well, you know,
Terry and I get along once in a while.
If you're respectful of each other's opinions,
right.
And don't offend each other, then, you know, you're going to find that, you know, I may be totally against you on this, but next time around, I'm going to need your vote because, mm-hmm. you know, you feel the same way I do about it. And Keene is very blessed not to have a partisan city council.
Right.
True.
There is no party here.
No D's or R's.
No D's mm-hmm. or R's. And I think that helps because that roadblock, just having a D or an R next to your name, mm-hmm. especially when you're talking the legislature or Congress, tends to be an impediment because if I'm a D and you're an R, my leadership said I'm not supposed to talk to you.
Exactly.
That right away, that stops the discussion.
It does.
And, you know, and there's many things that need to be done. Compromise is the name of the game, but you can't compromise if you don't talk to each other.
And you know, Terry and I are living proof that anybody can get elected to city council.
Yeah.
And, you know,
how many times you've come in there?
Quite a few. Yeah. You go there and do your job, you get reelected. And we've seen that you don't do your job, don't automatically think you're getting reelected because you're not. You know, people pay attention.
There have been some candidates, some incumbent counselors this time around. We had one a very good counselor.
You're seeing my face instead of Terry's because our cameraman is crawling around out here, but he'll get it corrected. We'll see Terry in a second. There you go.
We've had incumbents who've who've won accolades from state level organizations for doing such a good job, who get voted out. For one reason or another. Sometimes it's because you take your voters for granted and you don't talk to them, or maybe you just said something that just
really ticked them off.
And I'm surprised I'm still around because I do that a lot.
Yeah, I'm surprised too.
Now, the position, Jay Kahn's position that's available, how long is that for? Is that a year?
Yes, it fills out his term. He was an at-large counselor, which is a 2-year term. And it will be just until the end of this year.
Okay.
In November, that person or that seat will come up for re-election again.
Mm-hmm.
And one thing I wanted to say about it is the time commitment. There is a minimum of time that you can put in. But, we've had retired people. We've had people with more time who just totally dive into the job. And you can spend as much time as you want on issues. You know, you can pick out, safe streets or whatever like that and really get into it mm-hmm. and make it your project. Or I think the minimum is you have to go to 2 council meetings a month. They will appoint you to one of the three standing committees, MSFI, which takes care of the roads and the police and the fire department, things like that. PLD, who deal with the planning services and all that sort of thing. And then there's finance, where any project that goes through any of the other two committees has to go to finance to get funded. Mm-hmm. The city council meets on the 1st and 3rd.
1st and 3rd, Thursdays of the month.
Thursdays. And then the committees are on the 2nd and 4th. MSFI and PLD are on Wednesday nights, and
finance
is on Thursday night.
So basically prepare for at least one night a week. Yeah. That's the absolute minimum. If you just do the minimum one night a week and that's all you can do, maybe council's not the perfect venue for you because it really does take more time than that. Mm-hmm. But that's the minimum. And the great thing about this particular time around is it's only 11 months. So you can get in there and realize, oh, geez,
right,
I don't have the time commitment.
I like it. I don't.
Now, you did planning board for years, right?
Yes.
And so,
for
a
long time.
That's a heavy lifting job.
That is heavy lifting. We went on site visits.
Right. Now, technically, it's one night a month. Technically.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? When we talk about city council meetings, mm-hmm, one night a week, planning is one night a month. However,
you go on the site visits.
Oh, and there's no homework, too.
And there's a ton of homework. The packets are very, very thick. And the meetings go for hours and hours and hours.
Yeah. That's like...
And I loved it. Loved it.
Yeah. Well, you're just...
I'm on zoning board in Marlboro now, so... quite a different setup than Keene's.
In Marlboro's. Marlboro's within Cheshire TV's...
they have three view.
So,
three
to those of you in Marlboro's not now? Am I seeing a no?
They still get the channel. They don't pay anything.
Oh, Marlboro, pay up. Come
on.
So anyhow, you get to see one of your residents now. So there you go. And then, of course,
your collection did. Okay, moving right along.
So anyhow.
So put
your name in. And $2. You gotta cough up $2 also, mm-hmm, to put your name in. Mm-hmm. And then
I'd recommend it. It's a very rewarding.
It really
experience.
Is.
It really is.
You know, it's very rewarding. And then, you know, for those of you that just think you heard it on the radio or read it in the paper, that's like the little tip of the iceberg. Mm-hmm. And stuff you usually read is usually not 100% correct anyhow. But we won't go there. it's one a
fake.
No, we won't go there. But any article,
gosh, was I at that meeting?
any article that's written, obviously, is that reporter's viewpoint of, mm-hmm, of what they saw, and then it goes to the editor, and the editor edits what the reporter saw. So, I mean, Terry's kind of correct there.
Yes.
You've seen it too. You read the article the next day, and you're like,
wait a minute,
was I there? Was that the one I just saw? So, well, that's one great thing about Cheshire TV here, though, because now people can actually watch the meetings live.
Yes.
And if we're there as a city councilor, now you can't say, oh, the paper got it wrong or the radio got it wrong. So they can hold us accountable. Unless the guy behind the screen edits and changes stuff, then, which he's going, no, he would never do. Never, ever, ever, ever.
My guy.
So anyhow, that's another thing going on. So if you're considering, you know, putting your name in, go ahead and do it. You just have to speak in front of the council for 5 minutes and say, this is why I want to do it. Mm-hmm. And, no previous experience required. It's just $2.
There you go.
So what have you been up to? You're usually the noisy one. Now,
I know.
Now Debbie is a little quieter today because...
Don't say why.
I won't say why. we're editing things. She's just out there in the community. And, Deb has to be kind of the moderate one. I don't know if that can ever happen.
Which I am the moderate one. You just don't want it so that when somebody sees my name, they see, ah, you know, screaming Republican nut job. Nut job, yes.
Well, that's not. I was gonna say that's not gonna change.
Republican, no, moderate.
Is that what it is? You're the moderate.
I'm the moderate.
You kind of are.
I am.
You know, compared to some of them that are out there, you know, we've seen
this
a few.
This is true.
I mean, all you gotta do is go on Facebook and social media to see the nut job.
You should talk.
Oh, I always...
Did you, like, take a bit of pill every hour?
Oh, I have fun.
Your posts are like, boom, 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 boom.
Well, I enjoy, but as you've seen my posts, I'll put something factual out there. I will take an actual fact, I'll put it out there, and then I sit back,
I love doing that.
Light a match and throw it.
I have friends on this side and friends on that side, so I'll just say something. Sometimes I do it on purpose.
Absolutely.
So just say something very controversial and just let them go. It is absolutely hilarious.
I agree.
You know? And these people don't even know each other.
No.
You know, they're from different parts of my life, right? But
they
start calling me up and say, who is this person?
Right.
Oh, yeah.
Were you offended when I said this? And I said, say it like it is.
No, absolutely. Just throw it out there. And it's like being on a fishing boat with a bunch of sharks around, just throw a little bit of meat out there. And
it's Facebook, you know. It's fun. It's this. If anybody's taken it to the point of where, oh, my God, I can't stand you anymore because of what you posted, is that lighten up.
Exactly.
Right.
Lighten up, Francis.
Yep. No, and you'll see it on there.
Which Francis is that? Is that a Freudian slip?
One of the things I noticed on there, I was going to make a note on that too, as far as social media harshness. I put a little line there, social media harshness. And that's exactly what we're talking about. You throw something out there, mm-hmm. and it's like sometimes it's like a feeding frenzy.
It is.
And, well, even with what's going on in Washington, it's like, try to stay somewhat moderate with each other.
Yes.
Now you can go in there, and I'll be harsh on Trump because everything that he said and done, I just basically judge on what he said and done.
Right.
But as far as other people coming in and disagreeing with you, then personally attacking you.
I don't like that.
You know, it's like, wait a second, because you disagreed, now they're going to personally go after you.
Right.
And so, you know, we're giving a little, you know, lesson here on being polite on social media. Be polite.
I think so.
Even when Terry and I throw things out there, just
be
polite. Social media is actually the best thing that's ever happened to this country. I don't think there's any time in our history where so many people have been engaged in discussions mm-hmm. about, you know, very important issues that go around us. You know, we complain that, well, they don't know what they're talking about. Maybe they don't do enough homework or anything like that. But they're talking about things.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, you remember Jesus Christ Superstar, where they said Israel in 4 BC had no mass communication, you know? And then the beginning of this country, you know, you had to travel for a week
mm-hmm.
to get to a town meeting, you know, or to a convention or something like that. And but now, anybody can engage in the issues of the day.
Mm-hmm.
And I think that's just so important.
It is. I think, and Trump figured that out with his tweets.
He did.
I mean, whether you agree or disagree with it or not, I mean, he took social media to the next level. Now the problem that we have to figure out with all this being relatively new, tip of the iceberg stuff, is you got to decipher what's true and what's not.
Yeah.
Because as we saw, mm-hmm. you know, the fake news that was thrown in there.
Yes.
Now, one thing that I disagree with Trump on is everything he disagrees with now he calls fake news. It doesn't matter if it's reliable news or not. I try to look in, and even when I throw something on social media, first thing you look at is what source did it come from? You know, is it, you know, I'm a right winger so much I fall down.com?
Exactly.
Or am I a left winger, you know, .com? Or did it come from two or three reliable sources?
Mm-hmm.
If I see it came from two or three reliable sources, then, you know, I'll throw it out there. But
yeah,
you'll see a lot of those.
Well, many times, though, even if you post something that comes from an unreliable source or biased source, the people that you're going to get responding to it, you're going to get their input and their opinion. So you're actually forming the news.
Oh, you'll get a feeding. You'll get a feeding frenzy.
But we're getting people's actual opinions. And face it, how long? We've never really gone out and asked people what their opinions are.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
You know, I mean, sure, once every term when you're running for re-election, you may go and knock on doors and hold meetings and you know, open houses and things like that.
Mm.
But, you know, that's many times so superficial, you know.
Yes.
So this is actually...
The same people show up. You have open houses, political open houses. I've done one. You've probably all done an open house. The same 10 people show up. They're just looking for your cheese and crackers and if you got some wine there. And
here we go.
And then the next time you go to somebody else's, it's kind of the same 10 people. You might have at one, 8 Democrats and 2 Republicans.
Uh-huh.
And the next time you go to the next one, you got the 8 Republicans and the 2 Democrats. But they're the ones that are always showing up.
Yes.
And then the average person, and that's where Bernie Sanders and Trump are so popular.
Mm-hmm.
They're from the people that just said, nobody's asking me. Nobody's talking to me. And once they pulled that curtain shut, we saw what happened. And, you know, in Bernie Sanders' case, he didn't have a chance to, you know, as you said.
Debbie Wasserman Schultz.
Yeah. Well, there's going to be
Debbie.
There's going to be quite a few formerly powerful people that
are. Trust those Debbies.
No. Terry and I said that when I said this. Deb Hamill's going to be on
Debbie
with us.
Debbie Downer.
We were like, oh my God, is going to be Deb on here? Isn't there going to be another Republican that we can offset this? So that's what we invited Jerry along, and now he's left us alone again today. Yeah. It's like brutal,
gonna,
man.
I thought he was going to be more like Jerry Brown.
So what else you got going on? We're gonna hit up on you now.
Not
you
know. Too much else going on.
See, Deb's a little bit quiet today, and we're not used to this.
I'm a little stoic today.
I understand that you've been newly elected as the president of the Lions Club. Is that true?
Yes, I'm the first vice president right now.
Congratulations.
Thank you. And in July, I will be the president of the Keene Lions Club. And I love the club. We do so much for the city. And we're working on the show Beauty and the Beast. We do a musical production every
Who's
year.
Who's the Beast?
I don't know.
Well, let me Randy. Make a couple of suggestions.
But yeah, the practice is underway, and we're just looking forward to it, and just an outreach. And we're going to Winchester, New Hampshire this Friday because they have an interest in starting their own Lions Club. So
really?
Three of us will be going over there. Yep, Ron Farina, Christine Greenwood, and myself.
Well, they have one in Hinsdale. Yeah.
Yes, they do have one in
they
Hinsdale.
They do still, yeah.
Yes.
Okay.
Yep.
So when do you officially take place as the top dog, Grand Poobah.
July is when I take over, and our meetings are every Tuesday. We have lunch meetings.
Well, the good thing about that isn't having this show here. You'll have a chance to spread the gospel, spread the word of
That's
the Lions
right.
Club. You know,
I agree.
In a much more subdued tone.
In a subdued tone.
You're going to have to put out little subliminal messages now. You know, it won't be quite so direct.
Oh, me? Well,
being with Jerry being on us when he's not sick. Yeah, you can.
Poor Jerry.
You can let Jerry be the pit bull.
Guy's got one foot on a banana peel and you're picking on him.
Guy shows up for one show and he's like, I can't sit with this many Democrats for more than an hour. You know, that's what you get, Jerry, for not showing up. Now he's going to have to deal with us for 2 weeks talking about him.
Oh, wow.
But, you know, talk about Jerry. And to talk about social media, that's how the show all came together.
It is.
When they were talking about, you know, nobody can get along off. And actually, it was Obama said that. Obama said, get off social media and actually start talking to each other.
Yes.
Because we all trash each other on Facebook.
Mm-hmm.
So we did. So we're all going to be here trashing each other live. We don't need a phone to argue with each other.
Yeah, this is the way it's done.
And that's what it brought about. And Jerry, I didn't know Jerry Sickels at all. He was one of those that I threw meat out there on Facebook that he grabbed the other end and started pulling at the bait, you know? And then finally, after we, you know, trashed each other on Facebook, we agreed to meet. I said, hey, look, you know, let's...
There was an interesting meeting on Sunday at the community kitchen. It was a unity lunch.
A group hug, basically.
A group hug between Democrats and Republicans in Cheshire County.
Mm-hmm.
They had this marvelous woman, Margaret, Rebecca, she's a storyteller. I can't remember her last name. She was just hilarious. She told stories of New Hampshire with her accent. And she just kept us enthralled for about an hour. Mm-hmm. We didn't get, well, because she was so good and kept on going and going, we didn't get to talk amongst ourselves as much as we wanted to, but... It was interesting. I had an opportunity to talk to many of my old friends on the other side of the aisle, mm-hmm. who I respect and sometimes hate. but it was something that needs to happen every couple of years, especially after a bruising campaign when a lot of things are said out of anger and what have you. You've got to get over that and become human beings with each other. And so that you can move on, because actually, you know, if you're elected official, you're representing the same people,
mm-hmm.
and you may have a point of view. And there's something I want to say about social media.
Mm-hmm.
Elected officials, if they ignore the things that are said on social media, they're doing so at their own peril.
Oh, absolutely.
Because this is input that we've never gotten before.
Right.
No, people that would never show up to a council meeting or a committee meeting,
right.
When they're saying that there, whether it's antagonistic or whatever, they're saying something.
Right.
They're saying they're paying attention.
Mm-hmm.
You know, some can be straightforward, some can be subtle, but you were absolutely correct.
Mm-hmm.
And once again, Trump tapped on that.
He sure did.
You know, he did. I mean, I can't stand the SOB, but he tweeted himself in.
He's
going to tweet himself out, too, but he tweeted himself in.
He'll mellow out, but I think he's still going to do it. It's just, why not? Instead of having the wrong message go out or the media write something the wrong way or there's all of a sudden these news stories going on. It's like, oh, he did this. And he's sitting there going, I didn't do that. And then he does a tweet. I think he just needs to tone it down.
Well, one thing about Trump, though, I mean, he'll tweet. You can say, Donald, you got a pen in your hand. I don't have a pen in my hand. Yeah, well, that's the Trumpster.
Well, that's something you know, we're going to have to get used to. Is usually there's been a bit more decorum to the office.
Yeah.
yes, you know, I think everybody needs to agree to that. Is it hasn't been normal for a president to be so thin-skinned.
He is
thin-skinned. For a job like that, you need to be able to take some heat and just shrug it off and move on and. But I'm not sure his strategy. Who's to argue? It's worked so far.
It's working.
Well, they're starting to figure out. You know, how do we work against him? How do we? And what do you find out with Trump? Because he is thin-skinned, and they pulled it off the other day. They said, his poll says his popularity is down. That stuff drives him nuts. Not that
it drives me nuts too. Poll schmoles. Look at how wrong they were for the election.
Exactly.
And who's to say if he's popular? If he's this or that, he's not even president.
But he cares about that. He worries about that.
Right.
You know, North Korea, China. You know, Russia and his big brother Putin. Not so big deal. But what? My poll's down.
I like the one about people encouraging others to share those photographs of him with his mouth in weird positions. You know,
like that. Yeah. The only time Trump's mouth in a weird position is when he talks, which is all the time. But
moving right along.
Number 2-1 here. Hi, Jerry. That's what you get from not being here.
I have
here.
All kinds of things I want to say, but let's move Sam, along. We spent Sam. A lot of time.
We're trying to. You know.
I don't think it's thin-skinned. I think it's just he's a tough character. I mean, it's like me. I don't consider myself thin-skinned. But if something was going on and somebody was saying something about me, boop, 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 I'd be right there. Bing. Wrong. Wrong. Wrong.
Yes, you would.
Yeah.
Actually, you'd probably be on Cheshire TV, Channel 9, all the radio stations, you know, setting it straight. That's downtown right. Marlboro with a bullhorn.
Mm-hmm.
Well, moving on from stuff, well, you know, kind of moving on. I get a bunch of stuff here. We all get a bunch of stuff. We get a half an hour left to talk about it. See how we go a half an hour and talk about nothing for 30 minutes. Speaking of Trump, and the one thing that's bugged me about him, he's taking credit for the auto industry, Ford, Fiat, Chevy, all their the production areas that they're going to be increasing spending on. But the truth of the matter is, these were planned for months and in some cases years. And so, you know, Donald, knock it off. You know, he had nothing to do with any of these. These were all done under the Obama administration. And even Fiat came out and said, "Look, we've been planning on this."
Don't give the kudos to Obama on this.
But the problem
if there was kudos to Obama, it would have happened.
Yeah.
But go ahead.
I'm sure Trump would have given Obama credit. I can picture that. Of course,
There is so much that a president can. I don't care which president it is. You know, you blame a president for this, and you give him credit for that.
Mm-hmm.
Chances are that president had little or nothing to do with it because they really. Don't have a lot to do. You know, people blame a president for this spending bill or that spending bill. Well, that's just because these people are bad in civics. They don't understand the separation of government.
Goes to Congress.
You know, Congress does this, president does that. I think that, people get a little bit overboard there.
Right.
Yep.
Give credit where credit is due, but... don't give too much credit because once you start giving credit, then you're getting in the way of making progress. Because if somebody has to be the winner, then there's going to be a loser.
Exactly.
Amen.
And then that's what I pointed out. As soon as Trump doesn't even know about these things until he actually reads them in the headlines. He reads it and then he goes, "Oh, that's me. That's me." He was talking about Chevy just came out and said, or GM, that they're going to be expanding on a plant. I read about this 6 months ago. I was reading it in an auto newsletter that Chevy's going to do it. Mm-hmm. They finally came out and said it. But what the auto industry is doing right now, because you know they don't want to be at odds with the president, the incoming president, so they're just saying, yeah, whatever. Yeah. But but as you said, you get all the credit, you get all the blame, and a lot of times it's somewhere in the middle. So now after Friday, if he wants to start taking credit for things, well. You know, woohoo, go for it.
Happy days are here again.
They actually are coming up. Happy days will be here in a couple of years at our next election.
Sorry, the cackle. It goes like the modulation.
I knew we'd get her going a little bit here. And one thing they did announce today on social media that it was announced that 2016 was the hottest year on Earth ever. Now that's exactly. Now this is what the Republicans want to do. They want to fall asleep because those damn facts get in the way of everything.
How is it the hottest in record? No, just I'm just wondering what were they saying? What happened?
Well, they measure the daily droughts? Temperatures. No, they measure daily the temperatures. Daily temperatures in areas across the world and compare them with the records that they've kept since
ever.
Well, the 1800s anyway.
Right. It's just every year is getting hotter and hotter and hotter. Yeah. And I mean, climate change is real. I think the denial that some far to the right have is how much of it's man-made. And the reason they argue it is because, you know, some industries that might be, you know, dumping, you know, carbon into the air have to cut back a little bit. And they're saying, well, we can't afford to do that. But this, you know, I mean, you look back in the 60s, 70s, mm-hmm. when we started doing Earth Days about water pollution.
Right.
I mean, all you got to do in Keene is go look at Beaver Brook back in the day and all the pipes that used to go into Beaver Brook.
Mm-hmm.
And the industries were saying, well, it doesn't really hurt. It doesn't really hurt the water.
Right.
Well, it does. And they had big smokestacks going into the air.
Mm-hmm.
So I don't
understand. Acid rain. Remember when there was acid rain?
Oh, yeah.
Well, there still is. And as a matter of fact,
it comes from the Midwest and comes this way.
The New Hampshire lakes and ponds were so acidified that they started to have to stock trout and such every single mm-hmm. year. Whereas when I was a kid, they were native fish. Yeah, they didn't do that as often. But the acid rain actually, mm-hmm. you know, it was, you know, Detroit in that industrial center out there sent tons and tons and tons of particulates into the air, and it acidified mm-hmm. the air mixture up there. And then when it rained, the wind blew it over here, and when it rained, it landed on the ground and in the ponds and. That's acid.
Especially for, you know, the Midwest and some of these coal-producing areas, you know, all that. It comes here, it rains, it comes down, it goes into the water. And that's what I'm kind of saying about here mm-hmm. with the global warming. It's like it's real. Just deal with it. It's not...
Well, there's an argument on both sides. You know, you have to be a bit of a scientist to understand it. But the world has gone through stages of warmth and cold because, you know, the temperature of the Earth has... oversimplified, it's simply how far from the sun is it at any particular mm-hmm. time? You know, there are different patterns. Every 76,000 years, there's a different different pattern, and it moves around, and the orbits get round or ellipsed or something like that. You know, the Earth tips back and forward.
Kind of like Republicans and Democrats, kind of.
So it does get warm, and it gets cold and warm,
yes.
and it ebbs mm-hmm. like that, but. Nowhere in history that we can tell by reading the fossil record and, you know, bores in the ice and such like that, has the temperature and CO2 levels raised so rapidly than in this industrial era. There was one other period, incidentally, it was during the Roman Empire. The Roman Empire, they smelted a lot of iron. They were the major, I mean, the world had never seen the amount of iron and other metals being smelted up until there, you know, that was one of the first, industrial revolutions. They really took off and they mm-hmm. spread out, you know, all of Europe and most of Asia and parts of Africa, you know, they really spread out. But they actually contributed mm-hmm. to something they call the Younger Dryas, which was the mini ice age, you know, 400 or 500 years later, which changed the makeup of Europe, caused fields of grain not to grow anymore, caused famines, and because of that they had to import things from Asia, and that's where the plague came from. I mean, there was a lot of things that happened because of man-made stuff that we throw into the air.
Mm-hmm.
People have to recognize it. I don't understand why they don't want to recognize it.
But there's been a lot done to rectify things like that.
Sure, we have scrubbers. We have scrubbers. We're trying to get rid of...
The aerosol cans. Remember that?
Fluorocarbons.
Yeah. Fluorocarbons.
We're trying to get rid of coal and fossil fuels as we can, but we're not doing that rapidly enough.
No, we need to listen to the scientists.
Yeah.
And that's one thing bugs me about the Trump administration. He's put in cabinet members that don't believe in it. It's like, you know, only hurting ourselves, you know, with ignorance on that part. It's not a Republican-Democrat thing. And, you know, it's almost like, and we'll get to this because we talked about it last week, about solar power.
Yes.
it amazes me that the government hasn't been more on board, because you can create jobs. You take new industry and create jobs. You don't have to, and I know during the campaign, you know, Trump and Hillary get into it about the coal miners down in, mm-hmm. down in West Virginia. Instead of saying, we're going to bring coal mining back and we're going to put you back down in the damn mines, say, you know what? We're going to bring in solar. We're going to give you jobs that's cleaner and healthier, and you're not going to die of black lung disease. You know, deal with, you know, today's economy. Well, and quite honestly, those coal miners that think those jobs are coming back, you've been fooled. They're not.
The same phenomenon happens regionally everywhere. And we can say that it happened right here in Keene with the fall of the machine tool industry. Mm-hmm. This region used to be very strong in that. You know, we had some of the best machinists in the world, mm-hmm. and many, 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 many of them. But when the machine tool industry started moving elsewhere, the workers here were never really trained for anything else.
Right. That's true.
And our economy has just been so blasé ever since then.
Right.
And we don't seem to know what to do about that.
Yeah, I mean, it's tough, you know, leading into that, you know, as far as, you know, local economies. I mean, Keene, compared to a lot of areas, we've done well mm-hmm. maintaining. And we were just talking about a story went on air, how Samsung Manufacturing has bought a big building on Optical Ave and are investing millions into it.
Who bought that?
In the Samsung's.
Swansea, right?
They were actually up at Black. They had a small place up at Black Brook, and now they've relocated down at Optical Ave. And if you go down there, it was just an empty building that they're investing millions in. And it's manufacturing. What they do is they actually make different things for guns. You know, sights and different types of things. They don't actually produce guns. They produce parts for guns. So I can get into the whole anti-gun movement or whatever, but we're not going to on that. But it's manufacturing. You know, just like Kingsbury Machine used to mm-hmm. make machines and accessories for cars. They didn't build the car. They had parts and things for cars. Mm-hmm. Well, this is like, you know, what Samson's doing. It's a manufacturing. These are good paying jobs. And bringing manufacturing in, we hear it all the time.
And especially clean industry.
Exactly. And people say to us all the time, why doesn't City Council bring, you know, manufacturing into Keene? Well, the truth with the economies are, because there's fewer and fewer manufacturers now because of computers and robots, mm-hmm. that communities like Keene, we do everything we can to keep what we have, because everything we have, other communities want. Mm-hmm. You know, the CNS, the Samsons, you know, those type of businesses, other communities in other states get tax incentives too, where New Hampshire doesn't.
We were able to keep Markham when Amage took over.
Yep, they're
very fortunate to do that.
Because we saw what happened with Kingsbury's. Yeah. That just... You know, completely.
And MPB.
A lot of them. The old Optical Ave, and that's why it's so great, you know, Samson's down on Optical Ave. It also fills a building and keeps the area vibrant.
It does.
So now maybe the next manufacturer looks at Keene and says, you know, well, look at that. You know, mm-hmm. Keene worked with them. MEDC worked with them. You know, they bought a building, and, you know, maybe we can go in there. But one thing Terry pointed out, too, is you need the workforce.
Right.
You need people to be able to fill those jobs. And and Samson felt we did have it, but people that were in, well, say in West Virginia in the coal mines, mm-hmm. or here working in some of those plants, you know, that had the same machine for 20 years, a lot of people are going to have to get re-educated in today's workforce. Mm-hmm. It's a totally different workforce than it used to be.
It's so competitive, bringing, you know, businesses into the communities. It's gotten to the point where I don't agree with, you know, it's almost like bribery, where you know, communities are bidding on, okay, we'll give you a cut on your taxes for 5 years. Mm-hmm. Oh, they'll give you six, we'll give you seven, you know.
Right.
When we start doing stuff like that, I mean, what's the point? Mm.
And a big thing that happens in Keene that people don't realize, when they say, people that are outside of the area that say, bring business in, what are you doing? Keene has on this new thing of, well, it's not new, 10 years old, mixed use. Mm-hmm. So it's redo an old mill, redo this, and, you know, have the bottom part be restaurant, store, business, and then have apartments upstairs. And I'm just wondering if you two could fill me in on the middle school. That has been purchased, right? Mm-hmm. The old Keene Middle School on Washington Street.
Yep.
And I saw they have new windows in there. That must have cost a fortune.
They're spending some.
So there's that happening there. And then I understand where the YMCA was. That's knocked down, and MoCo is going in there.
Yep.
That's a separate project.
Performing arts, right. Yes.
But the project right next door to the MoCo project is the parking lot how many, 400 unit residential
housing? Yeah, it was upper threes, I thought, for residential housing. I don't know how they're going to fill them, but...
I don't know what's happening in the middle school. I believe they stopped construction, I heard.
That's what I had heard.
I don't know. But transitioning into what you were talking about, Court Street, the mixed use.
Mm-hmm.
We have a project, not Court Street, Marlborough Street. We have a project on Marlborough Street where we want to reconfigure the street, the neighborhood, rezone some things into some of the new zones that will allow mixed use things. We got a little bit of a disappointing news.
Uh-oh.
Is that we had applied for a grant, a transportation alternative program, or TAP grant, and we were asking for $784,000. But there were just too many communities. We came in 20th, and they only gave out 12 grants. I mean, it's a major blow to that project, because what that was going to do...
It definitely backs it up.
And
the scale of it now is obviously...
Yeah, we were going to make Marlborough Street. We still are. I talked with David Riches, who's chairman of the PLD committee, who's fathered this thing through. He's disappointed, but he's optimistic that we're still going to be able to move forward. Maybe apply for another TAP grant if one comes.
There'll be other grants out there.
2018, but this was going to retrofit that street to make it more pleasing, to make it easier for and more attractive.
Like its own little community.
Right, for commercial businesses to come down in there,
mm-hmm.
and to incentivize growth.
Mm-hmm.
It's just one strike. We're not out yet. We'll land on our feet.
And kind of going back to the middle school too. I heard things have slowed down a little bit, but of course I think at this point they're just trying to get the residential part up and going first. And I'm sure as they go, they're planning on a big restaurant and nightclub type of thing in there. They might be stepping back, saying, well, maybe we need to scale that a little bit. But the good news is they own it and they're paying taxes on it, and it's moving forward.
Bad news is parking.
Well, that's
because it's commercial business.
That's going to be tough.
Commercial business, you don't have to have a certain number. That you're going to have that is going to cause a lot, and the MoCo, like when there's a show,
mm-hmm.
the Performing Arts Center that's going in.
Well, at least MoCo, being right where the Y was, mm-hmm. they'll have some parking there. Then across the street, you've got the parking deck and. Parking in that area is going to be a premium. That was one of the arguments for the whole middle school reconstruction, was that, where you're going to park.
Right.
And it's like, well, I guess we'll just have to figure that out when a show comes. But it still remains to be seen if they still do shows in that old auditorium. And, I think it'd be great for local type things. Because, like the Lions Club and other shows, they kind of look for venues, affordable venues. And I know a lot of them, the Colonial, some of them are a little expensive for a local show to go to. But then you're going to have, the MoCo Arts is going to have their own new performing stage also. So
they are.
The good news is things are happening.
Yes.
Because a lot of communities, and I know we talk about parking, and I always come back with the alternative. Well, you go to a place like downtown Claremont, and there's parking everywhere.
Mm.
There's no place to go. There's no shops. There's no restaurants. Because downtown, it's almost like downtown Laconia. Mm-hmm. Downtown Laconia is a ghost town.
Right.
So a community on the opposite end of the spectrum where it's always trouble to find parking
mm-hmm.
is Portsmouth on a nice day. Mm-hmm. Go visit Portsmouth. It takes you a few times around Market Square mm-hmm. to find parking. But it makes you want to stay there. It's vibrant.
It's a healthy sign.
Yeah.
People are there.
You're like, I can't find a parking space. And it's not like you come into a community, there's nobody there, you don't want to park.
Mm-hmm.
The more that's going on, the more you want to park. So,
true.
But, definitely the middle school area parking will be a premium. And I'm sure Terry and I, when all that's done, the neighbors on Spring Street and Franklin Street and down through there, I'm sure we're going to see a few of them coming to council because they're narrow streets, driveways are small, a lot of people park on the side of the road.
Mm.
And when there's an event at night, I'm sure you're going to see people parked on the street. So,
mm-hmm.
But once again, I suppose in a way it's a good problem to have because it means things are happening. Mm-hmm. But, you know, stay tuned for the middle school project. That's something we have to look into. I know it slowed down a little bit. But I think maybe they were a little bit overambitious on their goals. I know originally they said, you know, November, December they'd be ready. And I looked at that. I was like, there's no way that's going to happen.
But we'll see. What's going on in where the police were? Right there, you know, where the town clerk's office is and everything. The people that have moved out and moved over to Marlboro Street.
That's the IT. That's the IT department in the police department now. It's where
basically computers.
Where it was.
Yeah. Basically computers and other IT. They used to have a training center there, but they moved that. Well, that's upstairs into where the police department was. There's a training center, and of course upstairs where the police was upstairs, and I think it was in their ante rooms. Is where human services is.
Mm-hmm.
So you know, all of the spots are full with one organization or another.
Mm-hmm.
And of course, it helped that the district court moved out too. So now that, I mean, we you know,
I was so inconvenient.
It was, if anybody ever, I mean, we'd go over there, you know, to pick up your package or something for a counselor. You'd go up onto the second floor to get some information.
Strip search every time you went through the
floor. Yeah, you'd be going up there with, you know, all of a sudden there'd be somebody in leg chains and in handcuffs getting escorted up the stairs beside you. So
exactly. Well, I was stuck in the elevator a couple of times with some sketchy fellas.
Yeah, you're like, uh-oh.
Well, it came to a point where I went and got a city ID. You can get a city employee ID if you're a city councilor or any other employee of the city.
I saw that one you had said, "I'm Terry Clark. I'm not a criminal. Trust me."
you just flash the card and you could walk right through. You know.
Yeah. We did. We used to have to get frisked on.
My wife got one of those at the airport. As a matter of fact, I get to walk through and get. I don't have to go.
Oh, I can't believe TSA would let you walk.
Oh
through.
Yeah, you apply for that pre-check. It's called pre-check.
Pre-check,
And it actually works.
Well, yeah. You don't have to take off your shoes. Nothing. You just walk right through.
Walk through an airport. Anybody can walk through.
You don't have
airport.
To walk through a metal detector. But, you know, it's none of those big long lines and taking off your shoes and your belt and your jewelry. And then putting it all back on. And it's, Jesus.
That's a pain.
And speaking of city-owned buildings, another one of my little notes here. If you haven't been down to Keen Ice, you know, you have the public works on the left and the police on the right, and the Keen Ice in the middle. If you haven't been there, you've got to go check it out.
Great facility.
I go down to watch every Keen High hockey game that I can get to. And by the way, they're in first place, undefeated, and phenomenal hockey team.
Fabulous.
I talk to parents from other communities a lot, you know, ask where they're from. And they used to hate coming to Keen because they used to have to get onto the fairground to the old barn and watch the hockey game there. And of course, there was an outhouse for a bathroom. It was pretty bad. It did its job over the years.
Right.
And now they love, nobody loves driving all the way to Keene but they love coming to this arena because it is state of the art. Mm-hmm. It's the best arena in the state now. Of course, it's the newest.
Right.
And if you haven't been down there, it's a proud building for Keene, I think. I think, I was on committees for 20 years trying to get a nice arena into Keene, and it was a slow boat from China getting that done. But everybody that got aboard Keene Ice, phenomenal project. So
thank you, everybody.
Really, absolutely. Work. Thank you. A lot of donations to that. We talk about, you know, CNS and the Cohens and the Putnams and
a lot
local
of hard-fought
people.
Battles for that ice.
And a lot of local money went into that. Mm-hmm. All the city did for that was we put some of the infrastructure in, you know, wiring and piping and things. But that was through donations from local people. So take some pride in it. Definitely stop down and see it. And even if you don't skate, just stop down and check it out. A phenomenal ice arena.
Mm-hmm.
And
it's a great place to bring the kids.
And that kind of leads into what you were saying about Marlboro Street. You got the ice arena at one end, and you get downtown here. Now it's a matter of connecting
right,
it.
Right, walkability. We've got to join the two and fill up some of those empty spaces.
Mm-hmm.
The old David Ford just went through the fitness center went bankrupt or something. So
like a lot of independent gyms.
I don't know. That business is very strange.
Yeah.
You know.
Right.
But then you know, there's the Kingsbury's. There's a lot of empty land there that's not being used and it's not very attractive. And the walkability is another thing.
Yes, the walkability issue.
That's very important.
And it'll be great. You'll see some. It'll be fixed up. There'll be restaurants popping up there because of the crowd. I mean, you've got to think that that's where the people are.
Mm-hmm.
So Keene will get it together, and they'll come up with the money, or we'll get a grant, and somehow you're going to see that Marlboro Street is going to be a whole different ballgame.
If I had a couple extra dollars on me right now, that's exactly what I'd do. I'd look at land and buildings right out where the ice arena is.
Yes.
That's 24/7, 365.
Yep.
And you've constantly got people coming in. You got figure skating coming in. You've, in the summertime, they actually have hockey schools.
Right.
In the middle of the summer. What a perfect spot to put up even just a small little Italian restaurant or sub shop.
Mm-hmm.
You know, for all those parents and all those people that travel in, that's a spot to build. And that's what's going
to
happen.
That's the place
that's
to
what's
be.
Going to happen. That's the place to start looking.
Well, we're starting to get some history on the number of people who go down to the ice arena, so we're going to be able to get that information out.
Oh,
and
good.
I hope that the committees that are working on the economic development plan start doing that, and with the chamber, start telegraphing that, you know, Keene does have this wonderful facility now, and there's an opportunity for a new sandwich shop. Or
absolutely. Right.
And we did touch on the Keene Ice last week and last week's program that we did 2 weeks ago now. So the reason that we're bringing it up again is because of the importance of it. And
absolutely.
And what it means to the city of Keene. It's not just an ice rink sitting over here. That's a whole gateway. We're talking about all the businesses coming in, and I think it's going to be great.
It is, because it's 24/7. It's busy all the time.
Streetscape.
They've got hockey tournaments going on. Like I said, they got the figure skating tournaments going on. These tournaments, plenty of parking. And when they do tournaments, there's a lot of people coming from overnight.
Yeah, tourism.
Now, they go downtown because it's a mile away as the crow flies, maybe even a half mile as the crow flies. But now your hotels are filling up. Now your restaurants are filling up. Mm-hmm. That's why I think at a restaurant down in that corner it would be a smart move.
Mm-hmm.
Or maybe the next hotel, you know, moves down on Marlboro Street. Mm-hmm. The whole mixed use. And,
definitely.
You know, hopefully within our lifetime, we will see where the ice arena is, where downtown is. We will see that whole corridor done.
We will.
Hopefully we see the blight of the former Kingsbury property, which Terry and I can tell you that's a battle.
In
that's sad.
That's many stories within itself. That's a very, very, very frustrating subject for us.
A lot of us who grew up in this area or have a partner or somebody, a friend, their parents worked at Kingsbury for years and years. And remember when you'd walk into the entrance and stuff, they had like the toys in the glass cases that Kingsbury made and everything. So it's just unreal when I drive by there and see it empty.
It's sad because all it is now is a hazardous waste spot. You know, from what it was.
Oh, is it brownfields?
Oh, it's brownfields, blackfields, redfields.
Well, that's the problem that's confronting the city, is that the current owner owes $600,000 in property taxes. They're making payments and such, but
the problem is that they
bought the property with intentions to sell it to the city. But the city doesn't want that property because underneath that building, we don't know exactly what's underneath it, but we do know what was underneath in the ground just north of it when they put in the new housing
on Water Street.
What is it? Just all the oils?
All of the oils and toxins and everything from 50 years.
Like little rainbow colors in the water.
Back in the day, and that's why we just talked about global warming, and we just talked about pollution. Back in the day, it was out of sight, out of mind.
Yes.
Well, you bury a 55-gallon drum of whatever, it's out of sight, it's out of mind, it's gone.
Right.
You know, they didn't think back then, well, that tank's going to rust through, it's going to seep into the ground, it's going to go into Beaver Brook, and it's going to contaminate.
Well, it's not even that. It's just 50 or 60 years of machines dripping salt.
That also.
Yes.
You know, and it just falls into the soil and into the water table. And with a river there, it's getting better because we don't detect any of that oily stuff coming out of the ground anymore like you used to.
Mm-hmm.
So their thinking is, do not disturb that.
Uh-huh.
Leave it like it is. As long as if they were going to tear that building down, they'd leave the pad.
Okay.
Just so that they would not disrupt that. Because once you start digging in that...
And displacing the soil, that's when other stuff comes oozing out.
Right.
I mean, there's a lot to be said for that. U.S. Senator, former U.S. Senator Bob Smith, was very big with brownfields and brownfields...
Superfund.
Superfund.
Yeah, he did a good job of that.
Getting money in, especially Winchester had the tannery.
Oh, God, yes.
Ugh.
The river was actually bright red in many days over there. It was...
Imagine the sicknesses, like if people lived right along that or you had your drinking water. I mean, when you look back and you think, oh, yeah, remember so-and-so lived there? Oh, my God, they were so this or that or sick, you know. But I think it's good that, you know, that has changed.
And it has to, because when you look at the ice arena in downtown, the Kingsbury's property is dead in the middle.
Yes.
Dead set right in the middle of it, down the bike path.
Mm-hmm. Well, isn't that where they always built industrial areas? Because it was the flattest, it was the easiest to build, the less expensive.
And they would dump things into the brooks.
Yeah, yeah. Hmm.
You know, they would blow the smokestacks into the air, and they would dump things
into
the
brooks. You change your own oil in your car growing up. Go over to the side of the house.
That's why we continue to need regulation on industry and such like that, no matter what anybody says you know, deregulate this, deregulate that. Well,
there's reasons for it.
We've been there,
just
done
not
that.
Excessive. But I do agree with what you're saying to avoid a lot of this. Well, look at this. Our time is flying by.
It is. With that, we got a couple minutes left.
Mm-hmm.
I did want to do a shout out to a gentleman. His name is Bob Hall. My wife Holly works over at Bentley Commons as a concierge, and I had a chance to meet Bob Hall. He was a World War II submariner. Of course, I did my submarine duty back in the Cold War. He was on a diesel boat back in World War II. I met with him last night. We talked for about an hour and a half. Phenomenal guy, you know.
Yeah.
And he served aboard the USS Parch, which he was at in a battle that the captain of the boat he was on got the Medal of Honor. And he was in that battle. And if you ever want to, for you military buffs out there, if you ever want to read a great book, it's called Battle Surface. And Bob Hall is actually quoted in here many, many times.
That's great.
And phenomenal book.
And
phenomenal
person. And Stephen Moore.
Yep. And I said, he's quoted in here many times. It was a Medal of Honor battle. One of the things I found out about submarines from World War II to the nuclears that I was on, there's a lot of differences, but man, there's a lot of similarities. They're big tin cans that go underwater.
It's still got to be crazy to get in.
Got to be crazy to get in. Crazy when you get out.
I know.
But we have 1 minute left. Any departing shots?
No.
For Jerry Sickels there. You know,
we miss you, Jerry.
Yeah.
Who knows? There might be three of us here one show for another. We have replacements that come in if we have other meetings to go to. So, ever changing.
Yeah, something like that. But you're not getting out of it that easy. Deb's like, I'm a little bit nervous. You know, geez, am I going to have to hold my thoughts? I'm like, seriously? You know, once again, it's like social media. Just throw Deb a little bit of red meat and let her go, you know? But that said, that kind of wraps up another week. You know, thank you, Terry, and thank you, Deb and
thank
Jerry.
You,
we'll see you in a couple of weeks. And to everybody, have a great 2 weeks. We'll be back.
Make America great again.